Sometimes we will have a patient who's not too frequent a recurrent UTI, but they do get clear patches between the infections. That's an indication that actually Hiprex is going to be incredibly useful.
Is it known which bacteria Hiprex is more likely to be effective against?
Okay, so Hiprex is known to be effective against such a wide range of bacteria. To be honest, it's effective against gram-negative bacteria, gram-positive bacteria, even anaerobic bacteria. So it has really a comprehensive mode of action against all bacteria that have been currently tested. Whether it's actually active against other microbial species, such as viruses, protists, fungi, I can't answer that question. And I would have to really delve deep into the literature to see if that work has even been done. But certainly I can reassure you that Hiprex is active against all bacteria.
Okay. And from a clinician perspective, is there something they can look for that might suggest Hiprex would be appropriate for a certain patient?
I think, yes, I think it's better to look at that from the reverse engineered side of that, in that you can actually almost predict your patients that are going to have issue with it. So Hiprex in the urine is a little bit of an irritant molecule if you're already inflamed in the bladder. So certainly when we are prescribing for a patient, we start them off with their antibiotics and get their infection under control to a certain degree. Maybe if the patient is a 9 out of 10 in terms of symptoms, we wait until the antibiotics have brought them down to about a 5 out of 10. Okay. And then we slide in the Hiprex on top of the antibiotic. And if they find that their discomfort increases, we say to them, you can actually reduce the dose of the Hiprex. You can actually take it down to half a tablet twice a day, or even half a tablet once a day, and build it up slowly. As soon as they manage to introduce the Hiprex alongside the antibiotics, we step up the bug killing and we increase the rate at which they get better. So I really stress the importance of trying to get onto the Hiprex. And we see in nearly all our patients that if we can co-prescribe Hiprex and antibiotics, that within a few months, we can peel those antibiotics away completely, leaving them solely on Hiprex. And sometimes some naturopathic adjuncts, maybe D-mannose if it's an E. coli or a Klebsiella infection, maybe, some garlic oil, oregano oil, a few, a little extras that we pop in there to just help enhance the reduction of the bacteria. And the inflammatory response, we know, lags behind, the healing of the inflammatory response lags behind the bug killing. And so we always expect this little catch-up time before we can introduce the Hiprex. There is another cohort of patients that we have to be very careful of. And these are patients that commonly suffer with dyspepsia, acid indigestion, gastroesophageal reflux symptoms. So your acid stomach patients. And they often don't tolerate it at a tummy level. So they will complain of it worsening their acid symptoms. And for those patients, an enteric coated Hiprex would be much more advisable. Certainly in the United States, this is available. I think possibly even in Australia, there is methenamine mandalate rather than methenamine hippurate. And it is enteric coated. So that actually gets around this problem. What I advise to my patients who are having this issue is, one, we get them onto a medication which brings down their stomach acidity, something like a proton pump inhibitor, such as omeprazole, lansoprazole, pantoprazole. We also recommend that they go and buy themselves quite easily from places like Amazon, gelatin or vegetarian versions of gelatin, empty capsules. Okay, so I'm just going to show you here. We've got a Hiprex tablet, okay? And here we have our empty capsule, okay? So can you see that?
Yeah.
And what we can do is we can just pop the Hiprex snugly inside the empty capsule, pop the lid on, and there we have Hiprex inside a gelatin capsule.
Okay.
That will help protect its journey through the stomach. Yes, the gelatin or the vegetarian gelatin will dissolve away from the tablet, but hopefully it has actually made it past the stomach by the time it does that.
Okay.
And it's really easy to pop it inside. These empty capsules are very cheap. The size that you need, because they come in different sizes, of course, is size 000, 3 zeros in a row.
Okay.
Empty capsules, buy them cheaply from Amazon, and pop's your uncle.
Yeah, that sounds like a pretty simple fix. We did get a few questions around heartburn with Hiprex, so that's really helpful. Moving on to how to take Hiprex, what is the typical dose that someone would take daily if they're on this kind of therapy?
Okay, the typical dose that somebody would take when taking Hiprex, if they were not catheterized, would be 1 gram twice a day.
Mm-hmm.
However, we know that the licensed recommendation for catheterized patients is 1 gram three times a day. The majority of catheterized patients are older patients. They are patients who don't tolerate drugs quite as well, sometimes have reduced renal function, and yet they tolerate three times a day without a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Although this isn't licensed, if we venture off license, as we often do as specialists, we can say to patients who are getting some effect from Hiprex but would like to have a better effect, that they can probably safely increase the dose of their Hiprex to three times a day, even alongside their antibiotics, to get a more efficacious effect in terms of reducing the bacterial burden.
Okay. If you are experiencing symptoms in between doses, even if you move to three times a day, is that an indication that the Hiprex is just not having a benefit and should be discontinued?
I think that's an indication that you need testing. It's an indication if you're getting breakthrough symptoms that absolutely you may be having a flare-up of an infection that the Hiprex is just not managing to quell. We do see these situations occasionally, and usually in these situations, you actually need a burst of antibiotics. We have plenty of patients who are maintained on just Hiprex 1 gram twice a day, and they will have the occasional flare-up. Sometimes it's after a trigger event, such as sex, dehydration, intercurrent illness, maybe celebrations that led to too much alcohol. First step I usually advise my patients in those situations is maybe increase the Hiprex to three times a day.
Mm-hmm.
And if that fails to have an effect, then consider coming back down on the dose or stopping the Hiprex and sending a sample for evaluation.
Okay. Is there a particular amount of time during which you should start to see benefit from Hiprex?
Most patients, are we talking about benefit from Hiprex when they've had a flare-up in that situation, or are we talking in general benefit from Hiprex?
In general, which I suppose some people start taking it when they have a flare-up, and for others it's more of a prevention.
Okay, so generally when we start Hiprex in the early days, it does take a little while. In the same way that when patients have recurrent and chronic UTI, in the main, it does take at least a few weeks to see some benefit. We are lucky. Sometimes we will have a patient who's not too frequent a recurrent UTI, maybe somebody who's come to us because they're getting half a dozen infections a year, but they do get clear patches between the infections. That's an indication that actually Hiprex is going to be incredibly useful. So if there is a patient that when they remove the trigger factors, such as sex, dehydration, alcohol, going in jacuzzis and hot tubs, actually can go for months on their own without an infection, without medication, we know that that patient, if we get them onto Hiprex, is probably going to be able to get back to leading their life normally with the trigger events, have a healthy sex life, go swimming, and not go down with UTIs.
Right.
But for the more seriously affected patients that we work with quite a lot, patients who just never seem to rise out of their UTI symptoms, we generally expect the treatment course to actually take weeks and sometimes even months before we start seeing their symptoms really melt away. But mm-hmm. what we see is we see a pattern whereby it's not smooth. It's very much, it's a pattern of steps. And it almost, I say to patients, you know, three steps forward, one step back. So we will see a patient who's been on the treatment for maybe a few weeks who say, do you know what? I had a good day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but then I was disappointed that the following day wasn't so good. But then a couple of days later, they have two good days, yeah. you know, and we have this sort of faltering improvement. But yeah. that's a good sign. So long as when you measure from week to week how you're going, things are generally heading in the right direction, despite a few hiccups, you're onto a winner. Keep going.